Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to our Sunday morning worship service. My name is Rick Tatau. Thank you for allowing me to serve as your chaplain here. If you're visiting with us in person or online, I welcome you. I'm glad you're here today. So Mike is sick today, our organist. He's not feeling well, so Joanne's going to help us out with the music, and the choir is going to lead us in the music. It's not my gift, so I'm glad that God has given that gift to many others. So I'm going to go over to the board first. So we've been learning about Jesus and the 12 disciples. You know what? We have done this for 10 weeks. This is week number 11, so we've got two more disciples to cover. We're going to go from left to right. This is Nathaniel, right? Next to him is James the Lesser.
Look over your shoulder.
Andrew.
Can't get him to come on.
When the Simon Peter.
Lost everything.
Judas Iscariot. John. In the middle is
Jesus.
Thomas. James the Greater. Philip. Matthew, good job. Thaddeus, Jude Thaddeus, and Simon the Zealot. Good job. Two more. Today we learn about Judas Iscariot. And next week, for our last one, we will learn about Thomas. Now on October the 1st, 2 weeks from today, we will have church in the auditorium for one Sunday down in Rickley. We will do a reenactment with Holy Communion at the Last Supper. So it'll be a beautiful way to finish up and congratulate all of you for sticking with me through many, many weeks, all through the summer, as we learned about Jesus and the 12 disciples. Okay? One more announcement. There are lots of prayer requests, so I will do that in a moment. Today, you have the opportunity to select your two favorite hymns. We will have a hymn sing on October 22nd. So if you haven't made your choices yet, you can still do that this Sunday and next Sunday. Whatever are the most popular hymns, those are the ones that we will be singing here in the next few weeks. Okay? So at this time, let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let us join together in the call to worship, which is in your bulletin. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you.
Let us join in our hymn, Near the Cross, in your songbook, page 57.
We don't have any music today. Oh, yeah, we do. We have a piano.
Thank you.
We are a congregation of many talents.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Joey. So we are coming to our time of prayer. Just a reminder, if somebody gives me a prayer request for another person, I don't mention the other person's name unless I have their permission. So, just so you know that, because I don't want to be the ones sharing information about people with it. They don't give me their permission to do that. But we can pray for them. That doesn't mean we can't pray for them. So, just kind of make you aware of how I do the prayer time. I will start with joys. It is a joy to see some of the people that we've missed the past few weeks back. Welcome back. And a joy that I've heard just this morning that Bruce is going on an honor flight this Saturday to Washington, D.C. So congratulations, Bruce. We pray for a safe and meaningful journey for you. If you want to learn more about that, you can talk to them and they'd be happy to share with you. It's this coming Saturday. We do have prayer requests. Pray for Mike. He's not feeling well. Continue to pray for Ken and Sandy. They are in quarantine. They have one more day from what I understand. So tomorrow's their last day. So I'd be glad to see them. We did have a prayer request for one of our residents in the hospital. So keep that person in your prayers too. And we give God the glory for good news, for healing mercies. Yes, thank you for sharing that today. So with all of that, I hope I wasn't missing anybody. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and holy God, you sent your Son Jesus to suffer and die on our behalf, to save us from our sin. Jesus, you know what it feels like to be denied, to be doubted, and to even be betrayed by those closest to you. When you made known to your disciples at the Last Supper that one of them was about to betray you, the disciples looked inward and questioned themselves, saying, "Surely not I, Lord." Holy God, help us to be like the disciples and look inward at the places in our lives where we have failed to be your church. Forgive us, Lord. Strengthen us in our faith when we are tempted to turn away from you. Soften our hearts when we become hardened to your will. Grant us the assurance of your presence and love when we consider giving up on our faith. Thank you, Jesus, for calling us to be your disciples and for teaching us how to live faithfully for you. We pray in your most precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Now, as Jesus first taught his disciples to pray, let us pray together, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
scripture reading for this morning comes from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 26, verses 47 through 50. While Jesus was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you are here to do." Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. On July 2nd, we started our sermon series on Jesus and the 12 disciples. I will be honest, I circled today's date on my calendar. Several people have asked me, when are you going to give the message on Judas Iscariot? Today is the day. The 12 disciples are men who Jesus invited to become his followers. The title most often used by the disciples for Jesus, and it's used in our scripture passage today, is Rabbi. A rabbi is a Jewish teacher. Jesus is a rabbi, and the disciples are primarily his students. Each disciple accepted Jesus' invitation, follow me. For 3 years, these men lived together in camps and in local accommodations. They ate together, slept in the same places, shared stories, witnessed miracles, and heard sermons. They probably spent more time together on the road with one another than they did with their own families. All of the things that they had learned about from their rabbi was to help them live more faithfully in response to God's grace in their lives. The Hebrew people are the chosen people of God. The disciples are Jesus' chosen followers. After 3 years together, the disciples become a brotherhood of believers. Or so they thought. In the painting of the Last Supper, which is up on the wall on your right and the carving on your left, Leonardo da Vinci places Judas Iscariot between Peter and John. In one hand, Judas is grasping a purse full of coins, 30 silver coins. The purse of coins is Judas' reward for identifying Jesus to the soldiers. With the other hand, Judas is reaching towards the plate near Jesus' right hand. This is based on Luke 22:21-22, which says, "But see, the one who betrays me is with me, and his hand is on the table. For the Son of Man is going as it has been determined, but woe to the one by whom he is betrayed." When Jesus says, "Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me," Judas in the painting appears to recoil away from Jesus and those near to him. Judas appears nervous. If you look closely at the painting, Judas knocks over a salt shaker on the table. Spilling salt is a sign of misfortune. The painting is Da Vinci's interpretation of the Bible. I pray for you as you reflect on your own interpretation of this Bible story. There is no way to make this story anything but what it is. This is a sad story. It is the saddest story in the entire Bible. No other story in the Bible compares. Judas betrays Jesus for 30 pieces of silver, or the equivalent of about 4 months' wages. Judas leads the chief priest to Jesus, greets him with a kiss, and they arrest him. Judas keeps his intent hidden from the other disciples. They did not suspect Judas of any wrongdoing. At the Last Supper, the disciples question themselves, saying, "Surely it is not I, Lord." Not once did they suggest, "Surely it's not Judas, Lord." They had no idea Judas was capable of such an act. Judas' fellow disciples trusted him, They freely elected him as treasurer of their group. They entrusted him with the money. Judas may have kept his treachery secret from the disciples, but he does not deceive Jesus. Jesus knew this was going to happen from the beginning. The betrayal was foretold in the scriptures during his prayer in the Gospel of John 17, verse 12. Jesus prays to God, "While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost, except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled." In Matthew 26, verse 24, Jesus declares a stark reality about the betrayer, saying, "It would be far better for that man if he had never been born." In John 6, 70-71, Jesus compares Judas to a devil, saying, "Did I not choose you, the 12? Yet one of you is a devil." Judas appears last on every list of the 12 disciples. He gets no sympathy from the other disciples. What do we know about Judas Iscariot? The word Iscariot in Hebrew is the phrase, a man of Kiriath. So Iscariot identifies where Judas is from. He is from Kiriath. He is the only disciple who's not from Galilee. Before Judas Iscariot, there was pride in the name of Judas. Judas Maccabeus was a Jewish priest who led the Maccabean revolt. The Jewish festival of lights, which we know as Hanukkah, celebrates God's protection during this revolt. Jude Thaddeus is one of the disciples that we've learned about. The disciples call him Thaddeus so they don't confuse him with Judas Iscariot. Jesus has a brother named Judas. He goes by Jude and has one of the books of the Bible named after him. The name Judas was an honorable name until the betrayal. After Jesus' betrayal, the name of Judas became synonymous with scorn and loathing. There is a prophecy in Isaiah that describes Jesus' betrayal. Isaiah 53, verse 7 says, "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shears is silent, so he did not open his mouth." Some of you may be familiar with farming. Sometimes farmers will use a goat to lure the sheep into the slaughterhouse. The goat is called the Judas goat. A close reading of the scriptures reveals Judas' corrupt nature. In John 12, verses 3-6, Mary uses an expensive perfume to anoint Jesus' feet. Judas Iscariot replies, "Why was the perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and he kept the common purse, and he used it to steal from. Jesus describes Judas' attitude in John 13, verse 18. "The one who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me." The main question still remains. Why did Judas betray Jesus? They spent 3 years together. Judas was one of the chosen. Why did he do it? The Bible does not say if Judas set out to betray Jesus from the beginning, or if this was a decision that he made over time. Perhaps he was sincere at first, but later learned that he could profit off his venture. Regardless, Judas sold information about Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. One of the biggest spiritual pitfalls in our lives is the love of money. Jesus explains in Matthew chapter 6, 24, "No one can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or to be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." The Apostle Paul writes to Timothy, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains." Hebrews 13:5 says, "Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have." Judas Iscariot served money more than he served the Son of God. Another possible reason for the betrayal is an unrepentant heart. I believe this is the main difference between Simon Peter and Judas Iscariot. Simon Peter was keenly aware of his unworthiness before the Lord and asked forgiveness after he denied Jesus. Judas Iscariot never recognizes his need for God's grace. When Judas does realize the consequences of his actions and comes to bear the weight of unforgiven guilt, he does not seek forgiveness from the one who can forgive him or from the one who he betrayed. He never goes back to Jesus. He doesn't ask Jesus forgiveness. Instead, he goes back to the high priest. The high priest turns him away. Judas is unforgiven. He never says that he's sorry to the Lord. Unforgiveness is a prelude to suffering, and for Judas, it leads to his death. A third possible reason for the betrayal is that Judas simply gave up on his faith. Judas shows us that falling away from Christ can happen. Being a disciple is hard work. Judas accepted Jesus' invitation to be a disciple, and at some point along the way, he lost his faith. Judas completely gave up on God and reverted to pursuing his own desires. What frustrates me about Judas is that he never talked about his struggles with Jesus or his brothers. Judas doesn't reach out for help. He never shares with Jesus what's going on in his heart. If you think falling away from faith in God can't happen, think again. Falling out of faith in God can happen, and it does happen. It probably happens more than we know. I have read a lot of articles about the place of Judas Iscariot in God's salvation story. I refuse to believe writers who suggest that God ordained Judas as a traitor. God did not ordain Judas as a traitor. It goes against God's nature to condemn a man and take away his free will. I refuse to make Judas out to be a hero who sets in motion the saving acts of Jesus Christ. There is absolutely no way Judas knew that what he was doing at the time would set in motion the events which lead to the cross. In fact, none of the disciples at the Last Supper understood that salvation would come through Jesus' death and resurrection. Judas' story is plain and simple. There are no good intentions in what he did. I do believe that Jesus wanted to help Judas all along. At the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus asked Philip, "How are we going to feed all these people?" It was a test of his faith. We covered that in my sermon a while back. Jesus performs a miracle and feeds 5,000 people. There are 12 baskets of leftovers, one for each disciple, including Judas Iscariot. Jesus teaches the disciples to reach out for God's help when you need it. Jesus uses this teachable moment to give Judas a chance to repent, to seek forgiveness, and to ask for help. Judas never asked for help. He never accepted Jesus' offer. The end of Judas' story is a tragedy. Judas ends his own life. Judas chooses death over living with dishonor. My word of encouragement for you today is this. If you are struggling in your faith and you need to reach out for help, there are people here who want to help you. Jesus will never leave you or forsake you. Jesus loves you more than you will ever know. He is always willing to give you a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance. You are his precious child, fearfully and wonderfully made. The journey of discipleship is not easy. By no means. It is hard. But you and I, we are not alone. God is with us, and we have each other. When you are on this journey, always remember, we are on the journey together. May it be so. Amen. We have one more hymn. There's an insert in your bulletin. It's one of my favorite hymns. This is the one I used. I used to offer this one to people that when I worked in hospice, and they really enjoyed hearing this song. It's called Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Do that through your local church or through the ministries here in the back of the chapel. So just pray about how you want to give back to God. So let us be in a prayer.
Jordan, do you know what I call you?
Let us pray. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you.
You want to say it?
We can.
Not yet. I'm going to say a prayer and then we'll sing.
Okay, just trying to work out the key. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for this day, this beautiful day. Thank you for so many blessings in our lives. Strengthen us in our faith through our acts of giving, that these gifts may strengthen others in their faith. Lord, we pray in your name. Amen. We're going to sing the doxology. Go ahead, choir.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son,
Hebrews 4:15. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Amen.